Yeah, hi there, everyone, and thanks for your time today, and thanks for Jellyfish for putting on such a tremendous event. It really speaks to their embrace of technology in the marketing vision and their forward-thinking behaviors in realizing these visions for their clients. We've talked a lot today about machine learning, and machine learning is just one form of AI, but for many people, and if you read in the press these days, it's often used synonymously with AI because it's the predominant form of AI. But I wanted to speak about another type of AI called evolutionary computation and what it's doing in the area of marketing and how it might change how you think about how you apply AI today into different parts of your marketing. About 20, 30 years ago, in fact, machine learning, neural networks, deep learning, all sort of versions of the same thing, were viewed as unlikely to succeed. In 20 or 30 years ago, people thought symbolic systems that represent knowledge were really the future of AI. But deep learning is proven with the advent of really strong compute and distributed computing to be very powerful, as you've seen today. It's a really powerful technology for perceiving the world. What did someone say? What did that handwriting mean? Siri is based on machine learning, as are many things. Understanding patterns in data, if this, then that. How do we look at various inputs and be able to predict an output, the face, you know, what is that face that you're seeing and how do I then put the snap effects on top of it? It's great for detecting, you know, sort of the flip side of that, anomalies in data, things like fraud detection. It's a very common use of machine learning, as is categorization. Is that, show me dog pictures would be a good example of that. So it's very powerful. And as Alex just talked about, once you've trained and developed a model, it's very fast, right? You get your inputs in and within a second or so, you get your real-time data out. But there are limitations to machine learning as a method. I mean, the first is that mainly that these models that are built are generally fixed in their purpose. They're built and designed to achieve a specific decision or goal, but they're not really flexible or adaptable. They're expensive and they're time-consuming to build. Now, 100 data scientists. King is a very profitable company. I play a lot of Candy Crush Soda. I'm currently on level 1,272, something like that. Mm-hmm. Really insane. I've spent a lot of time. And games also are time-consuming if they're done right and designed well. But in San Francisco, I don't know about here, 100 data scientists would cost about $50 million a year in salary. So that's just and that's what you need if you're really going to do it at scale. So it's not necessarily within the reach of everyone to hire up an army of data scientists to solve these problems. It also takes time to train a model. While neural networks work very fast when they're trained or built, sorry, to build and train a model, when they're done, the actual architecture of sophisticated deep learning networks can take something like 4 or 5 PhDs a year to do. So you can do the math. $500,000 a year per data science is very expensive. They're also a bit of a black box. You can extract rules out of neural networks, but in a lot of applications, you don't really know what's going on. And while that, I actually think that's okay. For many people in marketing and other businesses, that's not okay. You want to understand what are the mechanisms that are, you know, that from these inputs I derive these results. And in general, they're used for predictions and not so much decision making. But AI is many different things. It's many different ways to simulate human intelligence. And there are at least 5 different ways to do it. Some people would say more, things like symbolic reasoning, Bayesian statistics. And then there's evolution, right? And evolution is a little tough for people to wrap their arms around because it doesn't sound like intelligence. But yet, if you really think about it, it is the forces of evolution that brought us all here today. Like, no evolution, there would be no brains that we can then copy and model with using deep learning networks. So about 45 years ago, a guy named John Holland created something, you know, the first foundations of what are called evolutionary computation. And you also hear evolutionary algorithms, genetic algorithms. These are all sort of in the same bucket. And he looked around and he saw that, you know, if you look at life, there's maybe 2 to the 1.8 billion combinations of DNA, this unfathomably large number, but there's really only 9 million plants and animals, and they're all adapted and ideal for a given niche, whether it's a baby or a penguin, they're all designed well. That something about natural selection was really good at finding optimal answers or optimal designs, if you want to think of it that way, for a given problem. And so he adapted that into into math, something called schema theorem. So I actually couldn't tell you what all these variables are. But fundamentally, schema theorem defines the principles of natural selection and talks about how through the act of natural selection, things that good traits are propagated through successive generations. Bad traits are called out, and so by the process of evolution and breeding, you can create these sort of optimal answers, optimal designs, optimal solutions to problems. And there's three core concepts that really are at the basis of it. It's much more refined now, but in Holland's day, and still, the basis of evolutionary algorithms are three key things. One is a notion of fitness, the fitness goal. What makes something better than something else? Right? So in websites, that might be more revenues per user or games. In financial trading, that might be trading the stock market better. If you're an animal, it's really about having children, getting to childbirth. So that's the goal. Combination says if you have two successful designs, ideas, solutions, better than average, whether it's a racehorse or a website, and you combine them, or when we're feeling spicy, we say breed them. If you breed them together, that some of the children will be better than the parents. It's a way to advance along a performance curve. And then mutation, like in nature, is a really critical function in evolution to make sure that we're not just marching up a hill and getting to the top and calling it a day. Mutation spreads guesses, if you would, around the map of potential solutions for a problem and climbs all hills simultaneously, if you want to use statistical terms, and finds the best answer, not just a good one. And sentient is one of the masters in evolutionary computation. Now, we use deep learning as well. I don't want this to be that we're not pro-deep learning. We have another product that does visual product discovery for large fashion retailers, people like Skechers and Sunglass Hut and Zappos. You can find our technology in use on that site. And it's an ideal application for deep learning, how do products look like and relate to other products. Since we're the sort of smallest tech company here, we'll establish our bona fide. Sentient is maybe not a household name like Google or IBM or Apple or Amazon or others are, but in the world of AI, we're pretty well known. We've raised quite a bit of money. We do quite a bit of research in AI and a lot of patents, and we also are distinguished for having run the world's largest instance of evolutionary computation ever run. There's certain papers on that. We've solved some interesting scientific problems, and we use evolutionary computation for many different things. This is a very powerful form of AI for optimization. How do you get to the best result? We run a hedge fund. We do health work. We do agriculture work. And later on today, I'll talk about how are we applying this to marketing. But a few of the examples, we run a hedge fund. It's called Sentient Investment Management. This is one of the things that use that world's largest instance of evolution. We evaluate 40 trillion different virtual trading desks a year to find the one, or maybe two, that trade the best. 40 trillion trading desks. And those trading desks are combinations of rules that were randomly generated initially, but through a process of evolution, we arrive at these trading desks. And one important point I want to make is that evolution is not a black box. Evolution, if you're a trader and you knew our scripting language, you can understand exactly the trading rules that are being applied for this trader, which is important, by the way, if you're in the trading business. The SEC kind of wants to know, what are you doing there? But it gets us past that black box problem, the same way we can sequence the human genome now. As long as you can sequence it, you can understand it. So it's an advantage there. And we're using evolution to create a predictor for sepsis, one of the leading killers in the emergency room. And more recently, if you Google Sentient, you'll see a lot of stuff about cyber ag, which is this concept of how do you grow anything anywhere in a closed container. And Sentient's role in this is determining, initially for the herb basil, what's the right combination of water, nutrients, light, and shocks to achieve the best yields of basil inside this fish tank-sized container. Not just the most, though, it has to be flavorful as well. It's a multi-goal optimization. So, tremendously powerful and versatile technology. So we were sitting around with our prowess in evolutionary optimization. We said, all right, we're saving lives. This is good. We're solving hunger. This is good. How are we going to make some money here? And so we decided all those things take a while to achieve. We decided to focus on this whole world of testing and optimization, something that you've seen in our recent presentation, some others today, is really core to defining the best user experience, right? And if you look at companies like Amazon and Peter Diamandis, if you don't know him, well-known futurist, great newsletter, It's experimentation that really has made Amazon the success that it has, and that companies that want to compete on that playing ground have to be able to experiment at mass, at scale. And we don't all have 400 million monthly active users, right? So the problem we're trying to address is that A/B testing is slow, right? Even at scale, I think we heard it takes a couple weeks to finish an A/B test on these vast amounts of traffic, because individual lifts can be low to get to significance. It's laborious, right? You have to set up tests and determine things and build long lists of ideas and prioritize them, and generally it fails, right? Most tests fail. Now, it's different when you have a professional conversion optimization team, such as Jellyfish has, the hit rates are much better, but the industry average for A/B tests is something like 1 out of 4, 1 out of 5 actually succeed in moving the needle, right? So a lot of companies in your business don't do it, because it doesn't generate insights fast enough for the speed of your business that are material against the effort that you have to muster for that. So we saw an opportunity to fix this as well. By the way, multivariate testing, people say, well, let's just test multiple things. It's just slower. You're just time slicing it more. So we launched something called Sentient Descent. Sentient Descent's been out since September, so it's been 10 months. It's been a very exciting 10 months because it's a very disruptive product that's changing the face of testing and optimization in the market today for both small, scrappy companies and some of the world's largest enterprises in travel and telecom and retail are using the product now. And using this approach, I'll describe how we do it, you can test many more things at the same time than you ever thought possible on the same traffic you have today. So if you take a page like this, a design like this, you all have ideas, your team has ideas, how do I improve my performance, right? And you have these long lists. And in A/B testing, someone's got to decide which one to do. It's usually the boss, right? To a certain extent, it's opinion driven, because you got to pick one. But take this page, there's 13 different things that maybe you've come up with to improve your conversion on this page. And yet, if you look at the math, there's 2 to 4 variations for each. You get 1.2 million designs. You'll never A/B test it. You would never be around long enough. The robots will have taken over, and we would have reached our demise long before this test ever would have been done. But using AI, you can solve it differently. So using evolutionary algorithms, as long as you follow the rules of evolution, I'll talk about how we do that, you can solve this problem in just 600 tests. And those 600 tests, in turn, actually only take 15 different rounds of 40 tests running at the same time, each of which takes less traffic than an A/B test. So how is that possible? How is that statistically relevant? People sort of wonder. Here's how we work real quick. I'll page through this. In this Sentient Descent, let's say you had 9 ideas for improvement on your website or your email or your mobile, your mobile website. Ascend generates 9 different versions, like most testing platforms, but not just one other one. It generates 9 other ones, and you've set a goal. That goal might be revenues per user, and we assign users to test groups similar to other testing systems and see how they do. And as soon as we can, as quickly as we can, we want signal, but it doesn't have to be strong signal. It doesn't have to be definitive, statistical, anything. It needs to be enough to say, hey, these 5 changes individually worked better. And then we do what's called an evolution, and we create all the children of the successful parents. So maybe this headline and this layout, this headline, this image, this layout, and this copy, all this combination. So we have a second generation of running around with 2 variants each. And once again, we test them and the surviving parents still in the game, competing against their young. And we see which ones are best. And once again, we combine and create a new generation. Now, generations might take a week. They might take a day for really large sites. It might take hours. For something like King, it might take a couple weeks for smaller websites, but it doesn't take that long. And around the 3rd generation, we start doing mutation, and mutation brings back changes that didn't succeed in the first round. And we do this to avoid false negatives, but we do this mainly to find combinations that you never would have found on your own, and to make sure we're casting guesses all around the solutions map to find out what's best. And then typically what happens, evolution is never done. Evolution will always try to get better, to do better. But you reach with something that's called convergence, assuming your audience doesn't change. So assume your audience doesn't change. Obviously not true, but assume it doesn't. You'll hit a point where you've put in your ideas and you finally get the best combination. Keep trying. We've hit an asymptote. You're there. No one ever makes it that far. Not yet. Not in a year. Because the gains they see on the way there are worth harvesting and taking down at any time. No one, you know, for the final 10%, we'll start a whole new set of testing. So, you know, how have some people used this? Cosabella is a high-end lingerie retailer, and they distinguish themselves really by testing some major brand elements, right? Descend has also proven very good at taking lots of small changes and turning them into big results, but in their case, they wanted to look at fundamental message ideas. Are we made in Italy, or are we family-owned and operated since 1960? What should the colors be on the button? What should the cart, you know, copy be across the funnel? And in less than 7 or 8 weeks, sorry, in this case, let's go back. In 8 weeks, we achieved this result of about 38% more conversions. They went on to test their email sign-up, and they achieved our record in what can only be viewed as an outlying gain of 2,000% in email sign-ups. But generally, 38% is sort of more normative. And then you take this. Here's another example, a company called Above. Now, Above is an example of how you can use this kind of vast velocity for testing to achieve high conversion gains without testing anything large. A lot of things you'd never want to try to test in your A/B testing if you're doing it. A button color or a font, it's too small, it's not going to move the needle, and it won't. You shouldn't in A/B, but when you can test 10 or 20 of these things all at once, it can add up to very significant results. So Above is a next generation, you know, sort of publisher built on the affiliate lead model. And they want to get your name, right? They publish content about careers and how to achieve it. So they set up 42 different variations for 7 items on this. And Ascend runs through this process where it's testing. Let's get the video starting here. It's cycling through different things, evolving. And each time there's a generation, we see two things. One is that you find newer, better designs. And then the average result of the test is also going up as you go. So at the end of all of that, they saw, you know, rather than say search for this or search for that, that using choose and find and sort of things that promise reward was much better. These colors were much better, 45% gain. And this is this kind of consistent response you see in this. We haven't failed yet. We can't say we'll never fail. But when you have 20 or 30 ideas to try at once, you probably have some good ones. Evolution will find them. It will find the right combination from them. And it will deliver 10 to 40% results, usually in a month or two. In the interest of time, I'll skip past this. I want to talk a little bit about neuroevolution because there's no one truth to AI. And the real fun is coming from combining evolution to deep learning. What can we do to solve the problems of deep learning? Super powerful technology, but takes a long time to train and requires expensive staff. And that's really the exciting work we're doing here. How do you use evolution to architect the deep learning networks themselves, which can be, by the way, millions of nodes laid out in multiple layers? And so that's what we're doing at Sentient, and a lot of our research is there. And what this will bring about soon is the full personalization of marketing and e-commerce. It does many other things as well. So when you look at how this applies to Sentient Ascend, and by applies I mean roughly in January, rather than doing testing across an audience or your segment, we throw out your segments, your 5 segments, your 9 segments. Good, but they're like 8-bit video games compared to a PlayStation 4. And now instead you'd say, what are the characteristics that I want to consider for each user about themselves, about their visit, about their device, about the weather, where they are, whatever it might be? And Ascend will evolve a neural network that considers each of these signals and then produces the output from your ideas. It's not writing your site, it's taking your ideas and find the one that is best for each user. So it puts us in an era, we're not sure whether to call it personalized optimization or optimized personalization, but it will break through the challenges that we heard earlier are limiting us from achieving one-to-one goals. So, you know, in conclusion, evolution, very powerful alternative technology. It's changing the other side of marketing. We hear a lot about sort of the acquisition side, but as Jellyfish knows, and they're really leading with other agencies in their field, if you don't control both the acquisition and the landing page and the optimization, you're only in charge of half the story. And so we're working with Jellyfish and their conversion team to really build out and bring these capabilities to clients through various trials. So that's it. Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity.